Cebu Pacific welcomes a planned Senate probe into the surge of passenger complaints against the airline. The chair of the Senate Tourism Committee, Nancy Binay, filed a resolution to look into complaints of unexplained overbooking and overloading done by Cebu Pacific. Binay said the sheer number of passenger grievances has made it frustrating to travel in the Philippines. Binay will head to the joint hearing of the public services and tourism panels on June 21. Cebu Pacific says the inquiry should provide them the venue to put into perspective reports on their passengers' experiences. It also hopes to explain measures it has put in place in support of their passengers.
Higher tolls officially take effect on the North Luzon Expressway despite calls to suspend the increase. The Toll Regulatory Board says the hike was long overdue. Jackie Manabat with this report.
There's no stopping operators of the North Luzon Expressway from charging its users approved higher toll rates starting June 15. This despite calls of some lawmakers to put a brake on the increase and instead prioritize improving the service and roads of NLEX. Toll for Class 1 vehicles is now 7 pesos higher, while there's a 17 pesos increase for Class 2 vehicles and 19 pesos for Class 3. Senator Grace Poe on Tuesday demanded that the Toll Regulatory Board and the Metro Pacific Tollways Corporation explain in detail why the hike was implemented in one big swoop. The Toll Regulatory Board explained no one came forward to stop or question the increase when they posted the announcement months ago.
We respect the comments and suggestions of the good senator, Senator Grace po. Nang una, ang lahat pong yan ay naipalathala noong 2021 at noong April, tatlong beses kami napalathala itong mga petition na ito. Nagabang po kami ng mga posibleng maghahain ang petition for objection at petition for review. Subalit sa ngayon po kasi wala pa pong nagpapahala.
For now, there's no turning back. But if there will be a study that shows that the higher rates should have been lower than what was approved, then the TRB says they will give the money back to the motorists using the surety bond of 1.6 million pesos.
These are provisionally approved adjustments. Kahit po may mag-ain ng petition for review sa amin tanggapan ngayon, ay hindi po yun sapat upang pigilin yung pagpapatupad ng additional toll fee. Subalit, ang ginawa po ng aming tanggapan, being provisional in nature and required by law, nag-post po sila, ni-require namin silang mag-post ng surety bond. Kung sakasakali man sa ating pag-aaral, pagsusuri muli nitong mga toll fees na ito, meron nga dapat palang hindi ganyang kalaki. Yung pong labis na nakolekta nila, ay ibabalik po natin yan sa mga motorista by taking it from the surety bond na pinost po ng ating private sector investor.
The Toll Regulatory Board explained that the increase is a result of petitions filed over a decade ago, but it was not carried out in 2012, 2018, and 2020. For example, the 7 peso increase for Class 1 vehicle. This constitutes the 1 peso from the last tranche of the increase in 2012, while the remaining 6 pesos is half of hike petitions filed in 2018 and 2020. This means that the increase should have been 13 pesos for Class 1 vehicles. This also means that there is a pending 6 peso increase. Under the public-private partnership contract between MPTC and the government, private company is allowed to file a petition to increase its toll every 2 years.
These are contractual obligations of government, no? Hindi naman namin inimbento to. These were granted to us when we signed that concession agreement. Now, if government wants to encourage more PPP projects, sa akin, bottom line, respect provisions of the contract, no? Minimum naman yon. And what we're asking for is what is provided for and our right to petition for a tariff adjustment. Hindi nga binibigay yung buo.
The toll increase would be used to improve the expressway and its services. If deferred, the company may incur losses. MPT said they are willing to face and explain this to lawmakers. Jackie Manabat, ABS-CBN News.
The Philippine Finance Secretary urges Singaporean businesses to invest in the Sovereign Wealth Fund of the Marcos administration. Benjamin Jokno offered the fund during the Philippine economic briefing in Singapore, but Jokno touted it as a funding source for the nearly 200 infrastructure projects. The bill creating the Maharlika Fund has yet to be signed by President Marcos. The Senate Majority Leader said lawmakers are still applying finishing touches to the bill. Jokno encouraged Singaporean investors to back the multi-billion peso fund once it's officially passed into law.
The 194 infrastructure projects, okay? I think we want the Maharlika Fund to be able to finance some of them, or not all of them, right? So we have identified another source of funding for this very important infrastructure projects that will make a difference in the landscape of the Philippine economy. It has commercial purposes because the fund has to earn money. So you have short-term, long-term investments, and we propose to create several sub-funds, infrastructure fund, maybe green fund, and so forth and so on.
Philippine President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is confident that his administration's five-year export development plan will improve the country's lagging export industry. The program will introduce multi-level interventions to improve export quality and quantity. Pia Gutierrez reports.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. is confident the Philippines may become an agile export powerhouse in the next 6 years. This as the Department of Trade and Industry launched on Thursday the administration's Philippine Export Development Plan for 2023 to 2028. The PEDP lists down the government's strategies to further develop the Philippines' export industry and make it more globally competitive, particularly in industrial machinery and transport, technology, media and telecommunications, and health and life sciences.
As envisioned under the PEDP, achieving more than double our current level of exports is, in fact, a realistic target. We can transform the Philippine export industry into a significant economic engine that will generate over 1 million high-quality and sustainable jobs. The Philippines can establish itself as an agile export powerhouse by the year 2028.
The president says that while the country's total exports have increased, the Philippines still needs to catch up with its ASEAN neighbors. To do this, critical issues should be addressed, such as trade barriers and the lack of diversity in the country's export portfolio.
Came across a rather eye-opening statistic when we were planning on putting together this export plan for the Philippines, in that 40% of all our exports are only one product. So the level of diversification is something that we have to look at and we have to improve in the coming years. But we also recognize that there is a great potential in the sector. No less than $49 billion worth of revenues remains untapped and unlocked by the industry.
Aside from the PEDP, Marcos Jr. says the Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership, or RCEP, will also help significantly boost the country's exports. The RCEP is a free trade agreement among the Philippines, ASEAN member countries, and trade partners China, South Korea, Japan, India, Australia, and New Zealand.
Ang pinakamagaling sa ngayon ay nandito sa Asia. Yan ang kakompetensya natin. That is why we have to bring up our game, export game a little bit, and support our exporters so that they can compete in foreign markets and that they are able to be not only suppliers but also industrial consumers of the products that are around the world. In other words, to strengthen trade.
Marcos Jr. says other free trade agreements of the Philippines with South Korea, the European Union, and the United States are also currently in the works. Pia Gutierrez, ABS-CBN News.
Personal remittances of Filipinos overseas climbed to over $2 billion in April. This was 3.8% higher from last year's $2.67 billion. That's thanks to, mostly to land-based workers with long-term contracts. Cash remittances coursed through banks similarly up to $2.48 billion in the same period from growth in receipts of land and sea-based workers. Year-to-date, cash remittances reached $10.49 billion against last year's $10.17. The BSP says the growth was mostly from the U.S., Singapore, and Saudi Arabia. The U.S. also had the highest share of overall remittances. President Marcos will join a UN climate change conference to be held in Dubai. The president was invited by the United Arab Emirates to attend the 28th Conference of Parties, or COP28, from November 30 to December 12. Marcos says he is eager to participate since climate change is an important issue to the Philippines. Other world leaders are expected to join tens of thousands of delegates in firming up climate action. Marcos says his visit to Dubai would also strengthen bilateral ties with the UAE, which hosts over 700,000 Filipino workers.